Hey guys, welcome back to the LOFT Project. As always, I'm your host, James Robertson. Guys, welcome back to the Loft Project. As always, I'm your host, James Robertson, back for yet another episode. This is episode number 20. Right, back without further ado, back to tonight's show. We've got a very special guest coming live from Australia. So a lot of you may already know this guy. He goes by the name of the Aussie Cossack, also known as Mr. Simeon Boikov. So welcome to the show, brother.
G'day, mate. How are you?
I'm perfect, mate. How are you?
Very good. Very excited, you know. I'm excited, but at the same time, it's a very difficult time. You know, it's mixed emotions.
Yeah.
With the war that's happening in Ukraine.
Yeah. Well, first and foremost, brother, really appreciate you coming on the show. We realize you're a very, very busy guy. And, well, obviously, we wanted to have this plan for a while. I wanted to talk to you about everything that's been going on in Australia for the past 2 years. But with everything, with recent events, I think we obviously have to talk about the war or this, whatever. I'm not even sure we can.
Well, let's start with the first thing. Let's talk about the war because it's actually happening.
Yeah.
You know, the scandemic, the scandemic as we know now didn't even happen.
Yeah.
I mean, we could have just all had whatever was coming.
Yeah.
Had a quick cold or a flu and got on with it. I mean, we've all had it now and we know that it was all a scam in terms of what they did to us. It did exist. I'm not saying it didn't exist. It did exist.
Yeah.
And the worst thing was the freedoms. And all those people out there that were fighting for freedoms about, you know, lockdowns and mandates and protecting their children from the, you know, as we call in Australia, getting jabbed.
Yeah.
We were very, you know, working hard all these few years.
Yeah.
And it's amazing for me to watch now how so many people that were involved in the Australian freedom movement are actually waking up.
Yeah.
In regards to what's happening in Ukraine.
Yeah.
Well, people are overwhelmingly starting to understand that this is a great reset cabal establishment scenario.
Simeon, before we get into it, can you do me a favor? Because obviously, as I've just said, a lot of people will already know who you are. But for those viewers who don't know who you are, could you tell us a little bit about yourself and your background, please?
Mate, the best way to find out about the Aussie Cossack is to go to the Aussie Cossack channel.
Yeah.
And you'll see all the information on there.
Okay.
But the Aussie Cossack channel now is going to be doing broadcasts on this channel, of this gentleman from Britain. So no one can accuse us of being one-sided. No one accuse us of being Russian propaganda.
Yeah.
We're talking to a British outlet. We're talking to a person who's an independent journalist who doesn't have millions of subscribers or even thousands of subscribers. So ladies and gentlemen, if you're listening, subscribe to this channel because this is where all the information is going to be coming out for the next 2 weeks. Aussie Cossack going live on this channel with this fantastic British upcoming citizen journalist who is a truth seeker, because he found me. He came out of the blue and he found me. He said, listen, we've got to talk about the war. We've got to talk about what's going on. Not many people out there are qualified to talk about this war. What I'm seeing is a whole raft of millions of, you know, experts that all of a sudden went from being flu experts, spicy flu experts, you know, to vax experts. And now overnight they've become Russian-Ukrainian war experts.
Yeah.
I mean, that's all right. That's all right. You know, the reason behind it, it's an uncanny thing, but the reason behind it is because it's the same globalists and the same elites that are behind both operations. This is just the world's latest thing, the world's next distraction.
Yeah.
If we look at the history of the world in the last 100 years, every few years they need something. know, whether it's that, you know, millennial scare with the year 2000. Remember that?
Yeah, yeah.
That was just like this.
Yeah.
That was just like the last 2 years. Everyone's freaking out over nothing. Ah, mate, what about you know, the SARS, Ebola, mad cow disease? There's always something going on.
Yeah, it's always the next thing to be scared of. So they want us to constantly live in fear, right?
And that's it. And that's what's happened. This is a conflict that's been going for 8 years in Ukraine and Russia. Right?
Yeah, it's not.
Why all of a sudden has the mainstream media only now started talking about it?
Yeah.
24/7. And everyone's hashtagging I stand with Ukraine and hashtag Ukraine. And,
oh my God.
You know, the Angela Merkel is lighting up the bloody Brandenburg gates in Germany, which the bloody Red Army, you know, captured and liberated. How dare she do that?
Yeah.
You know, on those same gates, the Red Army had its insignia. You know, we lost 28 million. Soviet soldiers in World War II.
Yeah.
And their allies, we lost 40, 50 million. It's unbelievable how people have forgotten the lessons of World War II.
Yeah.
And World War II right now is being played out. It's so uncannily similar. People don't understand they're on the verge of World War III. This is World War Z, as it's known, as it's called.
Yeah. And just we see the mainstream media, like we've seen for the past 2 years, just falsely representing what's going on here. It's just totally propaganda, fear-mongering, fear porn. It's just, you know, and you see these same journalists, should we call them, in the mainstream media, who've now swapped their face diapers for flak jackets and helmets, you know, and it's just, and like you'll know yourself, I've seen many, many videos that are just completely faked, and it's just the, they're just giving a complete false representation of what's actually going on in there.
Absolutely, absolutely. Absolutely, mate. The people who are based, the people who are awake, who know what's going on and that have figured it out, and the people that are recently converted, so to speak, you know, to the free-thinking, freedom mind. And this is about. This is about staying out of the influence of the mainstream media. You know how many people out there watch the mainstream media like zombies, right? And then they drive around wearing a mask when they're in the car by themselves. And that's the kind of rubbish that the mainstream media does to people's heads.
Yeah.
And this is the same thing here. You said it correctly. The mainstream media has switched out the tactic. You know, they've put the whole scandemic to the side and we've got a new boogeyman now.
It's
the old Russia card.
Oh, yeah, Russia bad, Russia bad. You can just see, we've seen this narrative pushed, like you say, not only in just
the last 100 years they've been pushing this narrative.
Yeah.
On and off. You know, one year they're printing posters saying, Russian soldier, this man is your friend. He fights for freedom. You know, that's what America's doing. Next year they're saying Reds under the beds. You know, the Soviets are coming.
Oh, my God.
1991, again, the Russians are good all of a sudden because they got rid of the Soviets. A couple of years later, Putin takes power and the Russians are bad again.
Yeah.
And this is like a cycle. So with the situation in the world at the moment, it's very clear that the West is underestimating Vladimir Putin.
Mm-hmm.
They don't understand what they're getting into. Why would Finland, a country which Russia's been to war with so many times, right on the borders, Finland just committed weapons. And they didn't just do a Scott Morrison, you know, pussy move, Nancy move by saying, oh, so I'm going to give them weapons, and then he just gives them money instead. So he doesn't have to, you know, face Senate committee hearings of why there's now, you know, $150 million worth of Australian weapons captured by Russian rebels. That's what's going to happen to every single weapon that gets there.
Yeah.
Don't kid yourself. But the Finnish went a step further. They didn't just say money. They actually broke it down. Now, when I say broke it down, this is absolutely perceived as a threat to Russia, what the Finnish have done. The Finnish actually described publicly as propaganda, as military propaganda. They publicly announced exactly what material they're giving to the Ukrainians. Now, this is a very, very big development. When Russia sees a country like Finland on its borders, quoting directives, saying 2,700 units of this, 5,000 units of this, 3,000 units of this, right?
Yeah.
This is a threat to Russia. These people in these small European countries, these, you know, ministers of defense that they have there who are more interested in virtue signaling and, you know, diversity quotas, they're playing with fire.
Yeah.
Right? You know what kind of ministers of defense we have over there. You know who's in the NATO brass.
Yeah.
I'm not going to mention exactly, you know, what's wrong with them and so forth, but these people are completely unsuited for their roles. They're up against a very hardened Russian military machine that just finished a very similar operation 3 weeks ago. Very quick, in and out. Took them 3 days. Boom. Same thing happened in Kazakhstan.
Yeah.
Right? And in Kazakhstan, it was quick. No one had a chance to get involved.
Yeah.
And the Russians came in, boom, did their business, came out. Putin should be left alone. He is in charge of all that territory historically. At the very minimum, if the territory is not his and it's not part of Russia, it's in Russia's sphere of influence.
Yeah.
And Putin came out on the news and said to the Americans, how would you like it if I spent $100 billion arming some, you know, Mexican rebels on your border?
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
Arming cartels. What if Putin armed cartels with artillery weapons and missiles? How would the Americans feel about that?
Yeah, it's the hypocrisy of America and NATO. It's unbelievable. I heard on the, obviously I don't really watch mainstream media or listen to the radio, but sometimes at work it's you can't escape it. And the Americans were saying that Russia were going to use a psyop or a false flag to start a war. And I was like, my good God, how many times have the Americans done that exact same thing? How many times? How many countries have they invaded under the guise of democracy or saving people? And how many Iraqis have died? How many people in Syria? All these proxy wars that they fund and they help, you know, it's just the hypocrisy of the Americans and NATO in general, really.
We've just got news that the editor of Russian information agency Regnum has been included in the Russian sanctions list. Now, this is a very interesting development. They've actually started targeting journalists. So this guy's name is Modest Kolyarov. Okay. So in English, he's Modest. What a great name. He's Modest. He's a modest guy, and they bloody put him in a sanctions list. Now, these are journalists, guys. They're shutting down Russia Today, RT, very popular overseas.
Yeah.
And they've shut it out of Australia. They've shut it all over the world. Twitter, Facebook, shutting down in Russia. So look what's going on. Look what we have. We have a complete censorship war, an information war that's being conducted. Now, for all the good people out there listening in Britain on your channel, in Australia, in the United States, and all the people that listen to the Telegram channel, Aussie Cossack, and by the way, subscribe to the Telegram channel. The link is in the description below to keep up with all the updates about what's happening in the war. And subscribe to this channel because we're going to be actually doing regular updates in regards to the war on this channel. If you want to know the regular political news, the analytic, military analytic news, tactical news, strategic information, intel, before it becomes news, you're going to hear it here. Over the next few days, we're going to be running a special project with this upcoming British citizen journalist. So subscribe to this channel that you're watching this feed on. And getting back to what we're saying, they have to be very careful at the moment. I'm talking about the West.
Yeah.
They need to back right off. The Chinese are doing big drills in the South China Sea.
Yeah.
Taiwan, 24. Forget about these jets they're talking about. That's what everyone's saying. Oh, the Chinese put 9 jets in the air. Forget about that. Today, 24. In Russian, we call it the БДК, Большой Десантный Корабль. In English, I'm sure it's called the Amphibious Landing Vehicle.
Yeah.
You know, Amphibious Landing Craft, should I say. So, for unloading troops. Big ships, they don't carry many guns, but they've got a big door that opens in the nose of the ship in the front. And that's a ramp. And out come tanks. So this ship drives literally up to the shore and just armor comes out. They had 24 of them, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why would they need all of a sudden 24? They're practicing. They're practicing. It's called war games. Taiwan and all these islands out there, mate, China is so strong. And they're not going to be nice. Look how Putin's soldiers are so nice. Look how they're posing with people and, you know, posing with children on tanks and mums and dads and people liberating and saying, thank you, nice to see you. Thanks for coming. Welcome. We were waiting 8 years for us to liberate, you know.
Yeah,
that's what we're seeing now.
That was going to be my question to you. Are a lot of people in Ukraine seeing this as an invasion or are they seeing this as liberation?
From day one, I said it was a liberation. The mainstream media laughed at me. People in the comments section laughed at me.
Yeah.
You know, they were people that were unsure, people that weren't experts. you know, smart people knew that there's always a fog of war that goes 48 to 72 hours until the truth filters through. Now that we're on the fourth day and a little bit of time has passed, yeah, people are starting to get information from the front line. There are videos emerging everywhere all over Telegram.
Yeah, I've seen
plenty. People are comparing. Yeah. People are comparing the behavior of the Russian soldiers, the peacekeepers, to the behavior of the nationalist battalions, the Ukrainian Nazi battalions. That's what they are. And these Nazi battalions are committing atrocities, shooting civilians,
yep,
pillaging shops, pillaging churches, bashing priests, bashing parishioners that are trying to stop, you know, them from bashing the priest, women and children in a church during a service. And they grabbed all of the church valuables and they stole them during a service, and they stole the money. They stole the money personally from the people, and they just ransacked everything. And they even took the people's keys off them that were praying and stole their cars as well.
Wow.
When this happened in the city of Mariupol,
wow,
this happened, and the full video of this you can see on the Aussie Cossack Telegram channel. Link in the description below. It's disturbing, but it's happening. And we've put subtitles in English on that Telegram channel, so you can actually see what the Russian troops are talking about, the Ukrainian troops. There's subtitles in English. It's very hard to find that at the moment. It's on the fourth day of war, and there's not much information. Even the Russian government on the main channels of the Russian TV is not showing a lot of information.
Yeah.
Because it's a very, you know, Russian, it's a Russian tradition, right?
Yeah.
When Chernobyl's melting down, what do? You show photos and videos on TV of, you know, merry-go-rounds and happy days, and no one gets panicking, you know?
Yeah.
And you put people's favorite, you know, soap opera on, and everyone watches it, and there's no panic. You know, a big country like Russia, a big country like China, they fear panic. So everything's done to make sure there's no panic.
So when did they
shoot? That is the reason why the Russian troops have been ordered by the Russian Defense Minister, Sergei Shoigu, to not engage civilian targets, to not even be rude to civilians. I've seen video footage of people berating Russian soldiers, you know, yeah, you know, rowdy Ukrainian nationalists,
yeah,
berating them, even threatening to fight them. You know, there's a video of one bloke says, put down your machine gun and let's go one-on-one in the field. And he's filming the Russian soldier to his face, right? And there's like 20 Russian soldiers. In fact, they weren't even Russian. They were Dagestani soldiers serving in the Russian army.
Yeah.
And that's Dagestan Spetsnaz. These guys come from a place that was fighting for the last, you know, 15 years, street battles.
Yeah.
They're not mucking around.
Yeah.
These serious, serious elite crack, yeah, Spetsnaz troops. And you've got Ukrainian male, you know, young, hot-blooded locals berating them and filming them. And these soldiers are standing there and copping it on the chin. Now, yeah, if someone in Australia did that, right, same thing at a protest, you know, let's go one-on-one, I'll fight you in the field, take down your gun, the police would pepper spray him and smash him for intimidation or threatening, yeah, the police.
Shoot him with rubber bullets also, probably.
Mate, there was a bloke shot in Queensland in Brisbane at McDonald's a few days ago. You know, yes, he was, wow, carrying a knife and he was, you know, being a pork chop. He's a criminal. But why did they shoot him, you know, six times?
Yeah.
They could have just tasered him.
Yeah.
So what they're doing in the West is complete hypocrisy. And God bless Putin and his troops, who has so much self-control. It's unbelievable.
So what would you?
They're carrying. They're suffering casualties, a lot of wounded, and killed, because they are fighting a war with one hand behind their back. It's like fighting over the handicap. You know, there's a set of rules. You can't shoot anything civilian. You can't attack civilians.
You can't damage
civilian buildings.
So what would you? What would you say to anybody saying that? Because I hear many other truths. I mean, lots of other people saying this, that it's all a show. Even Putin himself is part of this whole cabal, this World Economic Forum, this elite. You know, there's a lot of people saying it's all a show, and they're all friends. And I've seen other people kind of sharing photographs of Putin and Bush.
Oh, come on. Let's not entertain the silly side of
things. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There is no way on earth Putin is part of this system. I can tell you why. Because if Putin was part of this system, he wouldn't have any problems.
Yeah.
He wouldn't be worried. People who are part of the globalists, who are part of the elite, leaders who are part of the cabal, and they, you know, it's basically like a sect. They're all together. They're in on it together.
Yeah,
all these Klaus Schwabs and all these globalists. It's sick what it is. And, you know, they're all in it. But Putin is defiant. He's uncontrollable. He's independent. he's demonstrated so many times in the last 20 years that he's independent of them.
Yeah.
You know, when he first came into power, he took over Russia when Russia was under the control of the cabal, when Russia was under control of the establishment.
Yeah, the Rothschild centralized banks, yeah?
Mate, do you think Boris Yeltsin was running the country? Boris Yeltsin was on the piss, mate. And he was completely incapacitated. It's actually because of Boris Yeltsin that Russia has all these issues now, all of its neighbors. You know, him and Gorbachev sold the country out and allowed it to disintegrate. I mean, it's just, it's a tragedy and it's a travesty. And there are people now in Russia, such as the paratroopers general here of the Russian Federation, Vladimir Shamanov, mm-hmm. who are calling for Gorbachev or Mikhail Gorbachev to be actually court-martialed for what he did in 91 when he brought down the Soviet Union under the influence of American advisors. Now, these American advisors that brought down the Soviet Union are the same kind of American advisors that came in 2014 into Ukraine and brought down a legitimate government. They staged the coup d'etat. Clearly, Hillary Clinton involved and her Clinton Foundation and the big bankers and the elites. And they took down this functioning, normal democracy, you know, free country, Ukraine, and they staged the coup d'etat. And they installed a puppet government.
Like they've done through a process. Like they've done many, many times in other countries as well.
Exactly right. It's a pattern. It's a pattern of behavior. And sometimes Russia steps in and stops it, like in Syria.
Yeah.
And the Americans tried and tried and tried. In Libya, Russia didn't step in. And we all know what happened to Libya.
Yeah.
You know, say what you like about Gaddafi. But Gaddafi, under his rule, Libya was prospering.
Yeah.
It was a stable, functioning country.
A lot of people don't know.
People love Gaddafi.
A lot of people don't know that. A lot of people, again, because everybody, a lot of people get all their news from the mainstream media, so you wouldn't ever find that out, would you, really?
Absolutely. Look, they've done it. They've tried it and they've bombed Yugoslavia. They've bombed, you know, look what they did in places like North Korea, Vietnam, Afghanistan. Wherever they get involved, there's a problem. Now, sometimes they have to get involved, you know. Let's say there was a serious threat. But here there is no threat to Australia. Why should we send weapons or from Australia? What for? Why should Finland commit not only money, but it actually lists what it's committing?
Yeah.
And this many howitzers, this many thousand, you know, rounds, this many thousand shells, this many thousand, you know, tanks.
How? Yeah.
Well, of course, Finland doesn't have thousands of tanks. That's an overstatement. They'll be lucky if they have three tanks. But, you know, in any case, all this fake help, like these big announcements, nobody wants to fight Russia, and hopefully no one does. Because if there's anyone out there who wants to fight Russia, then they should be assessed in a mental hospital.
It's game over.
If any leader out there wants to fight Russia and he's serious about actually fighting Russia and repeating the mistake of Napoleon and repeating the mistake of the Kaiser and repeating the mistake of Adolf Hitler and repeating the mistake of all these countries who come up against Russia. Russians have been fighting, you know, for hundreds of years, and all of their wars largely were defensive.
Yeah.
I mean, you name me a war where Russia actually did a, you know, British-style Falklands Islands operation the other side of the world and sent troops.
Yeah.
Nowhere.
No. But similar.
Russians' wars are all on their borders.
Yeah.
Whereas you look at the establishment, the, you know, NATO and the UN, you know, they fight their dirty wars everywhere.
Yeah.
In Africa, in Asia, in South America, in North America, in Europe.
People can't see the real issue here. You know, Russia faced with NATO build-up, NATO want to have bases on all along Russian territory and a build-up of weapons and mass and more kind of armies all along these borders, closer and closer to Russia. And people don't realize that these things have been going on, and just obviously through the mainstream media see Russia as the aggressor when that's just not the case, really.
Look, my friend, it's not their fault. They don't know what they're doing. They don't understand what they're doing. Most of them out there, like, look at these overnight TikTokers and Instagrammers, you know. Yesterday they're promoting lipstick and today they're talking about the Russian-Ukrainian conflict.
Yeah.
I mean, are they completely off their heads?
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, and people are liking and sharing and putting Ukrainian flags in their profile pictures. Mate, most of these people, if I pulled out a map of the world and said, show me Ukraine on a map, they couldn't find it.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just deleting people on my Facebook who are, like, virtue signaling and doing such things as that, because it's just, you know.
It's just, look, listen, for them, it's actually very, very, you could say, you know, sickening and tragic. For them, it's just the latest trend. But for people like us, Yeah. But people like us who actually have very strong cultural, you know, family and historical connections to those areas.
Yeah.
It's a tragedy.
Yeah, of course.
And we're fighting for our lives. And the Russian soldiers here are not fighting for their lives. The Russian soldiers are fighting for the lives of the regions of the cities which they're liberating. And there'll be monuments to these soldiers in the future. And the people who are being liberated will finally get to live under free, you know, democratic circumstances. Yeah. There are atrocities, stories of atrocities. Russians are liberating city after city. You know, and they're talking about how there are mass graves that the Nazis would shoot people who spoke Russian, people who, you know, wore Russian, you know, sort of T-shirts and ribbons, the St. George's ribbons.
Yeah.
People getting pulled out of cars and shot on the side of the road just because they have a Israeli passport. It happened today. It's a disgrace. You know, these right-wing Nazi gangs that are there operating using the SS ideology.
Yeah.
These are the descendants of the Banderovtsy, the followers of Stepan Bandera, who was a Nazi collaborator. Don't forget, the Western Ukrainians had a few divisions who stepped into the war as volunteers in the SS, in the Wehrmacht.
Yeah.
And that's why you see their tactics are very Nazi-like tactics, because the tactics they use are based on their sick ideology. For example, in the capital Kiev at the moment, you could compare Kiev to, you know, April 28th, 1945. You know, they're handing out guns to civilians, to boys, to grandfathers, to pensioners, you know, asking people to, forcing them, really. They're kicking them out on the streets. There's no food in the shops. You know, people are starving. There's no food in the shops. The country's government's collapsed, and they're giving them machine guns.
Yeah.
Now, how smart was that? The Russian army hasn't even entered the capital, and every night in the capital, there's gun battles. Small arms fire. There are gangs looting the city.
Yeah.
We call it in Russian marodyorstvo. It's looting, pillaging, people being raped and shot and killed. You know, in the morning there are bodies everywhere.
Yeah.
Not that there's no Russian army there yet.
But of
course, Russians are so careful. They've been ordered by the Minister of Defense and President very strictly. Don't attack civilians, don't put civilians in risk.
But what
so you see the difference between the Russian policy and the Ukrainian policy. The Ukrainians are literally hiding behind civilians, stationing their artillery next to schools, next to hospitals, in between residential buildings, doing this on purpose, knowing that the Russians would never launch a missile attack or an airstrike next to an apartment building or a school or a hospital.
I don't know about you, but I've seen videos that the mainstream media are sharing allegedly being Russian shells hitting schools and hospitals. And so you can just see the propaganda, the evil propaganda that the... What can we do against such a big propaganda machine as the mainstream, the Western mainstream media? What can we do?
We can fight for truth. We can fight for truth. You continue what you're doing. I'll continue... Yeah. Coming onto your channel as a guest, and everyone subscribe to this channel, because this is where we're going to play out the action. And we, you know, get a few subscribes going. Let us know in the comments and share this video so it goes viral.
Yeah, guys.
Put it on our Telegram channel. The Telegram channel, again, guys, subscribe to it. It's in the description below. If we keep pushing for the truth, we keep spreading the truth, eventually public opinion may turn. And I think already on the third, fourth day of the war, I saw a major shift. You know, I read the comments in the comment sections. The first day of the war, people were commenting, saying, you know, terrible things. Oh, Putin is bad, this and that, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
You know, and I was watching, okay, and then we started giving the right content, you know, giving direct from the ground sources.
Yeah.
The direct videos from the combat zone, direct intel from commanders on the front line. That's who I'm in contact with.
Yeah.
You know, this stuff that comes out on the mainstream media, by the time it comes out on your TVs, it's been pressed and repressed and redone, and oh my goodness, they spin the narrative. You know, they literally spin the narrative. And they do it for every time there's something, this is the new topic, the new craze, they spin the narrative.
Yeah. It just seems like, again, it just seems like a huge distraction from this big pharma fraud that we've seen for the past 2 years. And, you know, they're almost, with Russia and China, they're poking a bear. And it's people don't realize What kind of a dangerous situation we are actually in 2022? You know, I don't think they fully appreciate what could happen if things went the wrong way.
Absolutely. Look, it's one thing to poke a bear, but it's another thing to poke a bear when next to the bear is a dragon with fire coming out of his nostrils. So if you're fool enough to poke a bear, that's your problem. You got a bear and a dragon now. And the bloody establishment is so stubborn and arrogant, and they're so up themselves, and they believe in their own power. It's gone to their head. They're drunk on power, that they think they can push Putin away. They can actually poke him to death, so to speak, by threatening him. Every time they make a threat to Russia, every time they put sanctions on, it only increases Russia's ability as a strategic power to withstand pressure.
Yeah.
You know, because of all the sanctions before, because these sanctions have been going for the last 8 years.
Yeah.
Russia doesn't feel the effects of sanctions anymore.
Yeah.
You know, you get, you know, Joe Biden comes out and Merkel and a big announcement and I'm putting sanctions in Russia, Vladimir Putin, you know. And you look at Joe Biden, he's reading from a teletexter. And the poor bloke, you know, he's squinting. His eyes are squinting because he can't read it and it's going too fast.
He's so senile.
It's an embarrassment.
You know, he's not really, it's an absolute embarrassment. He's senile. The guy does, sometimes the guy doesn't even kind of remember his own name, I'm sure, and how to go to the.
I just love to see a debate. You know, like in the, you know, the olden day times and the medieval times, two armies meet and each army sends out its champion. And instead of fighting, they just
Joe Biden,
the champion.
Joe Biden versus Putin.
Yeah. Well, and that would be the most entertaining thing on the planet. It'd be, mate, if you put it on your channel, you'd have millions of views. Mate, it would be, I would pay big money to watch that happen, to see Biden talk to Putin.
But
I can imagine the conversation. Oh, Mr. What's that fella's name again? Biden, sir. Sorry, Putin. I'm Biden. You're Putin. You know, that's actually the level it'll have. That's how it will go. It's disaster. Man, we've seen the way it carries on. And it's embarrassing because I've got a lot of very strong, good, freedom-loving friends in America, the conservatives, the Bible Belt, the Texas and Florida, and all those great states out there.
Yeah.
And they love freedom. And that's why we've got a lot of followers and people watching this from the United States who agree with us.
Yeah.
And it's people who vote for Trump. And you know what? Let's just face it. Let's say it once again. I always like to say this. It was Trump that should have won that election. And the second thing I like to always remind everybody is that we have to free Assange.
Let's face it. He did win that election. It was they want you to believe that Biden got more votes than the first black, was the most popular president of all time, more popular, got more votes than the first black president. The guy never even came out.
Did Sleepy Joe get more votes than Obamacare?
Yeah.
Unbelievable. I didn't even know that.
Oh, yeah. He's supposed to be the most popular.
What are we dealing with? We're dealing with a NATO brass, which is so watered down and so soy and filtered down, you know, with diversity quotas and worrying about Wi-Fi and insurance and public liability and, you know, all this other garbage.
Yeah.
You know, Russian troops are there to fight, and they showed that in Syria. They defeated ISIS. No one could defeat ISIS. They were struggling for months and months and months. Remember when ISIS grew so large? And by the way, that was the whole, you know, trend back then. Remember the ISIS trend? ISIS, and then all of a sudden ISIS disappears. And then it's the next trend. Ooh, something else is coming. So we're just on the latest trend with this Ukrainian thing. We've the COVID trend has dropped.
Yeah.
They've gone silent.
ISIS, COVID must have completely killed ISIS, as just like it did the normal flu as well, because it's just that disappeared last 2 years also, right?
Look, it's a trend thing. It's a trend thing.
Yeah, definitely.
And the next trend, ladies and gentlemen, is what's happening now in front of us.
Yeah.
World War Z, they call it, WWZ. World War Z or World War III or Operation Z or Z War or something to do with Z. And this Z that's been appearing, this mysterious Z.
Yeah, on the Russian tanks. Like a meme. Yeah, it's on all the Russian tanks.
But it's becoming a meme. And the Russians obviously didn't calculate or didn't expect that their letter Z would become a world symbol for freedom. You look at the mainstream media, you know, is saying that today, what was it, the news.com.au, the Australian website, they said, this Z must be perhaps, it means Zorro's army. I mean, they're crazy. They're interpreting it all different ways. The funniest thing is it doesn't mean anything. The Russians just used it as a marker.
Yeah.
So they know which, you know, so they don't hit enemy tanks.
Yeah.
They've got a big, you know, letter on it. In the other fronts, the North Front, they've got Vs and they've got, you know, O's and all sorts of stripes. So it's also to identify their troops. But in the social media world, Z has become this sort of freedom symbol because the Z units, the Z armies, mm-hmm. are directly fighting the cabal at the moment. And why do we know that? Because Vladimir Putin has been standing up for conservatism. He's been standing up for family values. He's been standing up for traditional values. He's been standing up for the religious. He's been standing up for the Christians. He's been standing up for the Muslims, all the faiths in his country. You look at now, he's got volunteers. He's got huge divisions of Chechen fighters, of Dagestani fighters, battle-hardened. Yeah. You know, these fighters used to fight the Russians back in the 90s.
Yeah.
In the big Chechen wars, they know what street fighting is. God forbid if those Chechens have to be battling on the streets. The Russian military is doing its utmost to avoid this. You have to understand. And the cities where the Russian military now controls the area, completely peaceful. It's quiet. You know, humanitarian aid, there's food, people are being looked after. Thank goodness. The Russians are bringing peace. When I said the Russians are liberators on day one, people laughed. People didn't understand.
Yeah.
Now we're seeing evidence. Russian tanks are pulling into town. People are coming out and saying, oh, thank God you're here. We waited 8 years for this. You know, we've got Russian soldiers marching into battle and knocking on the door of their parents' house. There was a, you know, today they were showing it in the Lugansk area, Lugansk People's Republic, the LPR.
Yeah.
The bloke was a son. He went to war. And the parents lived on the Ukrainian side, the occupied side. And after 8 years, he liberated his own parents' house from the Ukrainians. And the parents came out, the mum was in tears, the father was in tears. And he came inside and they had something to eat together, you know? Could you imagine? Heartbreaking. This is the tragedy of the Russian people, of the Ukrainian people. We never considered ourselves different. We're all the same. Belarusians, Russians, Ukrainians, Kazakhstan, all these people, you know, all these nationalities, they live together in the Russian Empire and the Soviet Union. That's why Putin has, you know, armies of nationalities fighting under him.
Yeah.
You know, people are saying, what are the Chechens doing there? What are the Dagestanis doing there? They're all part of Russia.
Yeah.
You know, and so, Russia, look, it's thanks to the forefathers, the grandfathers, the great grandfathers that we have these lands and we have all of these people, because Russia never exterminated any nationalities. You look at what the West did. The British Empire, the Americans.
Yeah.
The Americans exterminated, they tried to exterminate, you know, lots of different people. In Australia, the British came, genocide against the Aboriginals, you know. In America, genocide against the Indians.
Yeah.
Terrible.
Yeah.
Tragic, absolutely tragic.
Yeah.
Why do you think in Russia there are so many nationalities? Because the Russian Tsars would actually conscript these nationalities to join their country, you know, and fight in their army and defend the frontiers and the Cossacks. And you know, the Russian history is excellent history to read and learn, and a lot of people are fascinated by it. Those that know history know that World War Z, you know, as they call it, or Operation Z, or this Ukrainian conflict, we need to leave it alone. We need to step back and allow Putin to clean up the situation.
Yeah.
Right? He's given his word. He's shown. Hundreds of cities have been liberated. No civilian repercussions. No people have been, you know, shot or massacred or blown up, or there's no damaged infrastructure. In fact, if there is damaged infrastructure, and there always is a little bit of collateral, it'll be Russia who will be paying for it to fix it. They'll be the ones who will be helping Ukraine. Do you really think that the Bidens and the Germans and the, you know, Swiss and all of these cabal states are going to be rebuilding the territories of Ukraine in the southeast? No. They couldn't give a stuff. No. There's been a war there for the last 8 years. They only sent weapons there.
Yeah.
They sent weapons, and they've been sending weapons and arming Ukraine for all of these years.
The bastards. What about something I wanted to ask you about? Is there any truth in there being multiple bio labs within Ukraine?
Well, it's proven.
Is it actually proven?
It's proven. This is Look, this is one of the reasons why Ukraine was such a convenient fortress for the establishment. Because there were no rules there. It was the Wild West. It was a pariah state in the middle of Europe. It's like what Albania used to be. Very similar situation, you know. Everyone knows who's from Europe. You need something done, you got Albania. You want to get something, you got Albania. You know, everything works. You need a liver, you need a kidney, you need a, you know, left lung, you need a weapon, you need some kind of form of, you know, criminal activities. That's where you go. And this is situation in Ukraine for the last 8 years. That's where the Americans put their biolabs, is they could get away with it. And it's reported that Vladimir Putin's forces on the first day, they launched a massive coordinated missile strike all over the country. Very, very serious show of force. You know, Russians are good at missiles. They've got a lot of experience in Syria, and they're using them very, very precisely, hitting precise targets. They neutralized 14 out of 16 biolabs. They left two remaining biolabs standing because the material, the contaminated material, the biohazard risk that is stored at those facilities, it's too dangerous for it to be released into the atmosphere. And this is what the sick things that this establishment gets up to. You look at the Russians. They made it their first priorities. You know what they captured first, the Russians, in Ukraine in the last 3 days?
I don't.
Yes. The first thing they captured was Chernobyl.
Ah, Yes. Yeah, I did see that report.
You know why? Because the Russians are responsible. They care for peace. They care for the environment. They care for the local population. And amazingly, the mainstream media doesn't report this. It's a very important fact. The Russian army, when it got to Chernobyl, the Ukrainian units surrendered, naturally. Because most Ukrainian regular army units surrender straight away.
Yeah.
And there are thousands and thousands of Ukrainians that have joined the Russian side. Because all of these Ukrainian officers and the Ukrainian military brass that are old school, when I mean old school, from the Soviet Union days, they went to the same academies as the Russians. You know, academies of the Gestapo, for example, which means basically the general headquarters. And they're all ex-Soviet soldiers, and the weapons are ex-Soviet. So they've all got a soft spot for the old country in the old days. And in many places, they're surrendering. And in fact, right now, as we speak, the Russians are controlling Chernobyl.
Yeah.
But they've actually left the local Ukrainian army in charge, left them all together. They're doing a joint operation only simply because the local Ukrainian troops who are tasked with Chernobyl, they know the reactor, they know the ins and outs, they know the zone, they know, you know, all of the procedures. It's a very delicate situation. It's in a sarcophagus, it's full of nuclear radiation. Anything goes wrong, one shell lands there, and Europe will be in big trouble. You know, forget about the war. We'll have another catastrophe. You know, that'll be the next trending thing. Chernobyl blew up.
Yeah.
You know, it's a very serious situation, but it just goes to show that the mainstream media won't tell you this story. They won't talk about the fact that so many Ukrainian soldiers are actually happy to see the Russians. I mean, why do you think we have so many weapons caches being captured by the Russians? All of these beautiful, brand new missiles and weapons and javelins and stingers and all this other Western, you know, state-of-the-art NATO weaponry is being sent to Russia. It's being captured.
Yeah.
You know, go onto our Telegram channel. Have a look at the latest updates in the description below. And you'll see all these videos of Ramzan Kadyrov's Chechen troops capturing brand new, you know, Swedish, you know, anti-tank missiles.
Yeah.
Now, do you think the Russians are going to forgive the Swedes for that?
Nope.
I mean, they probably will. But why would the Swedes even get their hands dirty?
Don't know.
What the hell is wrong with Finland?
Yeah.
And what the hell is wrong with Scott Morrison in Australia playing Mr. Tough Guy and saying, we're going to send lethal aid
to Russia. That was his exact words, lethal aid.
Mate, he's a lunatic. And then you know what he does the next day, what he did today? He goes, Vladimir Putin is hereby banned from entering Australia. I'm sure Putin is probably sitting there in the Kremlin doing a facepalm saying, yet, I really wanted to visit Bondi Beach in summer. What am I going to do? It's an absolute joke.
Well,
and Australians can see it as a joke because they see that, you know, they saw Tony Abbott. Remember Tony Abbott, the prime minister we had?
Yep.
In the G20.
Yeah.
He said, I'm going to shirt front Mr. Putin. I'm going to shirt front him. And oh, but the conversation I'll have with him, oh, it'll be the toughest of them all. I'm going to shirt front him. This is the embarrassing. When Putin rocked up, he brought the Russian fleet with him and he parked it outside of Brisbane. He parked the Russian fleet outside of Brisbane. And when Tony Abbott saw him, instead of shirt fronting him, Tony Abbott gave him a furry koala bear to pat.
Oh, my God. Well, I'm just thinking, aren't you lucky that Dan Andrews is not the Prime Minister, though? What would that guy say?
Mate, I would love to see Dan Andrews as the Prime Minister, because I'd love to see Dan Andrews and Putin go head-to-head. That would be hilarious. Dan Andrews is going to send, pledge to send five Hercules C-130 military transport planes full of masks.
Actually, that guy's gone like worryingly quiet recently. We were getting in the UK, we were getting like daily reports from about him, and kind of he was always press conference every day.
My friend, you know what it is? It's us. It's the Aussie people. You know, we get fired up when they got their foot's on our throat. Yeah. And that's when the pressure's on.
Yeah.
But now that they've given a bit of our freedoms back. Before the election, everyone's sort of gone back to normal. And they're like, yeah, whatever. Who cares about politics? Who cares about rallies? It's actually very detrimental to freedom. And it's a calculated move, a strategic move by the government.
Yeah.
In anticipation of the election, which is happening this year, they're relaxing the mandates all over the country. There's still, there's still people that can't get jobs and are out of work. And there's, travesty and tyranny and all sorts of terrible situations with nurses and firefighters and good hardworking Australians can't even go back to work because they're being basically held hostage in this medical apartheid which has been created here. But in regards to lockdowns and mandates, they're relaxing it. And of course, it's because the election's coming up.
Yeah, of course. Now,
if we lose the election, and when I say we, I mean the Australian people, if we lose the election, we're going to be in hot water because we're going to have a government who has another 4 years or, for the Senate, 6 years in front of doing whatever they like to us. It's going to be a very rough ride, which is imperative. We must put the major parties last. And there's a big movement all around the country at the moment that people are, they're awake.
It's growing exponentially from what I can see over here. And it fills my heart full of, it genuinely fills my heart when I see these videos of these huge protests in Australia and in New Zealand now and Canada, the truckers in Canada. It fills my, there's been various times over the last couple of years I've almost given up hope. I thought that the bad evil was going to win. And, it seems that this narrative now is crumbling before us. And that's why we see this whole thing with Russia is a distraction. Of course, it's this, like you've already alluded to, that this thing has been going on for, it's not a new thing with Russia, it's been going for a long time, and we're getting to this final stage what the West and NATO have wanted. They've wanted to get this reaction from Russia. But
I'll tell you something, my friend, it's a tragic situation. Leave it to the Russians to sort out. It's their backyard.
Yeah.
They're going to do the right thing. Everyone is going to be rudely, shocked. A lot of people will be embarrassed with egg on their face when Putin comes out on the right side of history as the liberator. I'm saying this again. I'm repeating it on air, on your channel. Putin is a liberator. Not always. Sometimes he makes mistakes. Sometimes Russia gets involved in wars that it shouldn't, perhaps. And, every leader of Russia you can criticize in the history, that they've all have their sort of pluses and their minuses. So I'm not a blind fanatical Putin supporter, right? But in this situation, with the Russian war, the Ukrainian war, as they call it, Operation Z.
Yeah,
Putin calls it a demilitarization. Denazification operation.
Can we really call
he's
it a
actually,
war?
He's actually in the right. Look, calling it war is probably warmongering, I would say.
It's an operation. It's a Russian operation.
It's a precision operation, I mean, when the Americans do this, and they do this roughly, history shows, every 2 to 3 years.
Yeah.
For the last 60 years, they've invaded somebody every 2 to 3 years.
Yep.
And that's what that's how they keep the wheels turning on their military sort of private economy.
Yeah,
you know, the military is a massive part of the American economy.
Yeah, the complex, the military, they need that for their the American economy runs from. They need war, right? That's why they've always
absolutely. But look, in Russia, they got the VPK, Voyenno Promyshlennoy Complex, is mostly completely, you could say, government owned. So the government has no need to constantly update contracts, whereas in America, there are shareholders that are, standing in Wall Street and saying, we want the share price to go up, start a war, we need dividends.
Yeah.
So every single bullet, every single pair of socks, every single toothbrush, every single, pair of helmets or glasses or whatever, everything the military uses, it's all costing this American taxpayer money, but it's making money for the private companies, the big corporations, the deep state.
Yeah.
They're all in cahoots together. And the way they've been conducting their wars in Afghanistan, $85 billion worth of top-notch military hardware was abandoned and given to the Taliban.
Yeah, just left.
What the hell?
Just left.
I mean, haven't they learned anything?
No.
The government hasn't learned, but I'll tell you something. The people have learned. And there are a lot of people now questioning what's happening in the world. I've never seen this level of people being awake. There's two. You're either awake or you're awoke.
Yeah.
Right?
People need to know the difference. Yeah. Anyway. Yeah, people need to learn the difference. People need to learn the difference. They think it's the same thing, but it's not.
Well, mate, put it this way. In a few days after this interview, there's going to be very good news, and the potential for the conflict to end is very, very high. Russia is conducting a very serious operation, and Putin is a chess player. He's already six moves ahead of Zelensky, of Biden, of all of them. In fact, he's probably 126 moves ahead of Biden. Putin doesn't even consider Biden as a threat at all. It's like, what? Oh. Biden? Yeah, anyway, next. Anything else? it's like buzzing a flyaway. And that's the tragedy of the mainstream media.
Yeah.
The mainstream media convinced the American people that Trump was a Russian agent.
Yeah.
But do you know who is the real Russian agent? It's Biden.
Yeah,
because if I was Putin, I would love to have Biden as my adversary opponent. And that you couldn't think of anything better than having an old bloke with dementia,
an old senile who's been accusations of pedophilia labeled at him, and all kinds of, and his sons, all the dodgy links that his sons had in Russia and obviously clearly
in Ukraine. Hunter Biden was all over Ukraine. Yeah. He was here long ago, making millions. And the disgusting things that they were doing here, and what they got up to—it's
been—that's
all.
It's been proven. It's actually been proven that the Democrats planned and orchestrated all those Russian, all the slurs against Trump, saying that he had Russian involvement and stuff like that. It's been proven that the Democrats did that. It's been absolutely categorically proven. Again, mainstream media, left-sided media, not reporting any of it, none of it.
Look, absolutely. And a lot of people out there know exactly what you're talking about, know exactly what I'm talking about, because this stuff is becoming common knowledge. More people getting their news from social media, from independent sources than ever at the moment.
Yeah.
That's why the government's declaring war on independent journalists.
Yeah.
War
yeah.
on independent citizen journalists.
Yeah.
There are no laws to protect us. They are targeting people all over social media, Facebook, Twitter, censorship, YouTube.
People
are looking at alternative.
It's modern platforms. Day. It's modern day Nazi book burning. A lot of it's like even the likes of myself. Not even a huge following. Just a normal guy trying to find truth and trying to give people the alternative to make a more informed decision about things that are going on. Facebook just deleted my platform of 14 years without any. And I'm nobody. I'm not some big media outlet, and they need to silence somebody like me. It's the censorship is crazy. It's rife right now.
All right, mate. Even the United States President Trump, his account was shut down.
Yeah.
And the Taliban's account was allowed to continue.
Yeah. Yeah.
What does that tell you?
Yeah, if they can deplatform a sitting president, then But
I honestly think that at one point or another, they must have realized that they didn't want Trump in the establishment. And that's when they went head to head with him. If they preference the Taliban over Trump, there's definitely alarm bells ringing.
Yeah.
And the fact that Trump came out and said Putin is a genius, he did a great favor to the free world. He gave us a message. He was giving us a signal. He was basically using his platform, his authority, his notoriety as the ex-United States president, Donald Trump.
Yeah.
To let everyone know, guys, don't rush into things. Don't make assumptions. Putin's on the right side here. Trump knew what's going on. It was under the Trump administration that the Azov Nazi battalion in Ukraine was actually outlawed. You know, and this was done on the level of, you know, United States lawmaking. Even the United States administration knew. They knew what was going on. You know, Azov battalion, in fact, at the moment, they're actually fighting the Ukrainian regular army. The Ukrainian regular army is much inclined to resign and surrender and, you know, seek peace. You know, these negotiations that took place 2 hours ago in Minsk, the first round of negotiations, it's a terrible failure. A terrible failure on behalf of the West. You know, these Ukrainian delegates that went there, they went via Poland. They had their iPhones on the table, and they had their cabal masters listening in and dictating what to do. Mm-hmm. And would you believe that there was no intention, you know, of any peace talks? Because the cabal doesn't need peace. The cabal doesn't want the Ukrainian and Russian people to live in harmony.
No, of course not.
The establishment don't want Russia to have strong, prosperous relations with its allies. They've been trying to cause problems on Russian borders for the last 20 years.
I know
Ossetia,
the
Abkhazia, Georgia, you know, Chechnya, you know, the same tactic they used in Afghanistan in the, you know, late 70s and 80s, where they armed the enemy, they armed the Taliban, supplying stingers to the Ukrainian, you know, Nazi coup d'etat rogue government is the same thing as supplying stingers to the Taliban to shoot down Soviet planes of the day.
Not only supplied them, but trained them. Like we've said,
unlimited amounts of money. This is taxpayer money coming from your pocket because you're a citizen of Great Britain.
Yeah.
From our pocket because we're Australians. From Americans' pockets, Canadians. Yeah. You know, we've got, you know, Canadian truckers are starving out there in the cold, and the government's sending, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars, if not billions, of money and aid and weapons to Ukraine. At the moment in Ukraine, there are weapons on every street corner. Mate, the Russians have destroyed and captured that many weapons dumps that it's becoming ridiculous. Have you seen the footage? Obviously, everyone's seen the footage they put on mainstream media. Massive explosions in the Ukraine.
Yeah.
It's almost like a mini nuclear explosion.
You know
what those are? You know what those are?
Weapons dumps or something.
Weapons, munitions dumps
that
are full of NATO weapons.
Yeah.
Now, why don't we see any video footage of that? Because there's no civilians around it. In fact, there are no even military people around it. The Ukrainians know that the Russians are coming, and the first thing they're going to target are these NATO, you know, military dumps of weapons.
Some of the
Seen videos.
Some of the videos they're using, especially the BBC, are so shockingly bad. Some of them are from like they've cut them out of films, or it's from like five years ago of military displays, or guys running about with wooden cut out guns and stuff. I almost feel like they're laughing at us. The mainstream media is just laughing. They're not even putting an effort into to try and make this propaganda.
The mainstream media is very cocky because during the time of the pandemic, they were like a fish in the water. They were in their zone. They had the full control, and they had the narrative under control.
Yeah.
They had all the sheep out there scared, believing the narrative.
Yeah,
we all know now that this wasn't necessary. You know, it was just like, you know, look, I had it. You know, my wife had it. We all had it. It's just like a bad flu. Nothing, no big deal.
Yeah.
No reason to stop the world and go into hysteria.
Crush,
and people end up committing suicide and losing
the economy.
Their businesses. And
yeah.
Bankrupting, bankruptcy. How many mortgages out there?
Yeah.
How many bankruptcies of businesses, of hardworking Australians
that didn't
deserve to get...
You know we're going to see the repercussions of this for years and years and years to come. You know, the mental... untreated cancers, undiagnosed cancers, suicide, mental wellness, people's companies and jobs that have been businesses that have been around forever, just decimated. The hospital.
But don't worry, this conflict that's happening now, it's like doubling down on the repercussions that you just mentioned, because we're not even going to have a chance to address those issues when an even bigger and scarier and more evil situation has appeared. and that is World War III. The intention here of the establishment is to drag every country into this war.
Yeah.
Putin was very, very firm and strict, and he hasn't been bluffing lately. When he says something, we have to expect that he's being serious. And he said yesterday, he warned countries, do not get involved. Very stern warning. And he put his nuclear missile fleet on the highest maximum alert to get ready. Do people think that he's joking?
No.
But does Biden think this is a joke? Boris Johnson, who can't even comb his hair properly
in
the morning.
Oh, my God.
Does he think it's a joke? Yeah.
Makes
Angela Merkel, does she think this is a joke? I know Scott Morrison thinks it's a joke. Scott Morrison is a joke. I mean, he wouldn't, you know, he's Scotty from marketing. Actually, I'd love to see Scotty from marketing, that's what we call him in Australia, have a debate with Putin. That would be hilarious. Because Scott Morrison was in marketing. That's how he became prime minister.
Scotty from marketing.
You guys don't know about that in Great Britain. Well, now you do. You learned it on this channel.
Yeah.
It's a bit of an Aussie slang for you.
But nobody wins World War III. Yeah. It's insanity, right?
Well, I'll tell you why it's World War III. So people don't think, you know, I'm warmongering. I'm not. I'm being very realistic here. I know exactly what I'm talking about. I know this conflict zone like the back of my hand. As I said, it's been going for 8 years. I know exactly what the places are, the names. I know the names of the commanders, you know, the villages, the people who are fighting, right? Yeah, exactly. What's going on. Now, these people who are talking about this conflict, they don't know anything about the conflict. These people that are, you know, projecting the Ukrainian flag onto the, you know, the Brandenburg Gate or to the Eiffel Tower, I mean, they're just doing it because it's the latest TikTok thing to do.
Yeah.
Where everyone follows a trend. It's like the Greta Thunberg, whatever her name is, or some Elon Musk bullshit, or, you know, one of these latest trends, and someone puts up a post on Twitter and everyone follows it. And everyone says, oh, Ukraine.
They're sharing photos
and videos and material on social media showing a Ukrainian tank running over a civilian in a car.
I've seen it.
Oh, this is Russian. Just to blame him on the Russians. Yeah. Mate, the Russians are so careful and polite. In Crimea, there was this thing, hashtag polite people. Visually, we're люди. You know, they nicknamed them the polite people because the Russian soldiers were so polite.
Yeah.
You know, I've seen cops, you know, in Sydney. And, you know, on my channel, I've got all these videos of cop interactions.
Yeah.
And in Melbourne, and we document and we film the police and during the lockdowns. Mate, they were bashing people, pepper spraying them, shooting them in the back.
I've
seen videos in the last 2 days of Russian troops that have come in as peacekeepers, and they're just standing there peacefully, quietly, you know, and they're just being nice to people, and then there's no civilian casualties practically. It's amazing.
I mean, talking about Australia, I saw a police chief calling protesters cowards when you've got these police in full body armor with rubber bullets and wooden batons and pepper spraying, CS gas, and all these other things that they've been using, attacking people. And not only attacking people, but you can see it in their eyes, even behind these, that their masks and their helmets, the pleasure they were getting from attacking Australian citizens, and just all around, all over the world as well. And I've never liked police anywhere, but just they're... I hope that somehow they will be held accountable for their actions. Everyone will see which side of history police force acted. You know, in Britain, and I think it's the same in Australia, but they were allowing Black Lives Matter protests. They weren't wearing any kind of combat gear. They were taking the knee. They were just letting these people riot
and loot,
smashing things up.
You guys are watching that in Great Britain?
Yeah. And then you have people over here just simply peacefully protesting for the right to make their own choice about their own body autonomy, their own sovereignty about something that goes into their own bodies. And they're being physically attacked by riot police and arrested, and people coming to their doors for what they've written on Facebook.
Well, mate, that's why
dystopia.
That's another reason why they hate Putin, the establishment, because he never mandated anything. And Russia had very, very low rates of experimentism, if we can call it, because obviously we don't want your channel to get striked. And this is very important. These bloody YouTube and Facebook and Instagram, Twitter, they're all unreliable. You know, Telegram is a good channel because it doesn't censor what we talk about.
Yeah.
And that's why, you know, we use Telegram at the moment. So look, guys, if you're listening, subscribe to this gentleman. It's an excellent channel. You can see he's got 189 subscribers today, but by tomorrow morning, he's going to have thousands. Because I know all of you listening who support the Aussie Cossack are going to hit the subscribe button, support this guy, support independent media. It's a very good thing to do. So the more journalists we have out there, the more citizen journalists, the better. We need as many eyes on the establishment as possible from all directions to catch them out, keep them on guard. We've got to win this battle. This battle has been going. It didn't start yesterday. It didn't start 3 days ago. It didn't start 2 years ago. It's been going for a long time. And we're at a culminating at a peak. You know, we're at a point where World War III is on the table. China is very, very prepared. You know, the moment there's a slip up, the moment there's a weakness, there's a change in the balance of power, we're in trouble. Which is why we need to negotiate with Putin. I think that the Russians will offer the West to have a demarcation line drawn at the city of Zhytomyr.
Yeah.
And Zhytomyr is a city which is basically in between the West and the East. Now, the Russians haven't sent any troops to the West. The Russians are only sending troops to those regions which are full of Russian citizens and Russian speaking.
Yep.
Now, if you look at a map of the ethnicities, of the languages, you can see that the Western Ukrainian regions were the stronghold, you could call it, of the, you know, fanatical nationalist Western Ukrainians, the same ones that collaborated with the Germans when the Germans invaded the Soviet Union.
Yeah.
All of these Ukrainians, you know, defected and said, oh, great, Germans, we're going to join you. We can't wait to kill Russians.
Well, people
served in the SS.
Yeah, well, people will think that we're actually both crazy, saying that there are, to this day, Nazi regiments still act within Western Ukraine, right? Still actively fighting in Ukraine.
Well, the first thing is the descendants of those people, but also this ideology in 2014 in the coup d'etat that was sponsored by the CIA and the deep state. That coup d'etat came to power, tapping into that sort of sentiment, using that sentiment, tapping into the sentiment of, you know, that nationalist Nazi ideology. And there's nothing wrong with being a nationalist. You know, I'm a nationalist of Australia. I love Australia.
Yeah.
There's no problems with that. But it's when people start using SS symbols and, you know, the Hitler skull, the SS skull, and putting swastikas up and doing Nazi salutes.
I've seen the swastika for that. Yeah.
That's what they're doing. And that's when Putin told the West 4 days ago on the first day of the war, when he said, I'm conducting a denazification campaign, they didn't believe him. You know, they thought, oh, it's a joke. Yeah. All these virtue signalers on Twitter thought, oh, Putin's bad. What's he talking about, Nazis? Oh, Ukraine. I stand with Ukraine. Blue and yellow flag. When people scratch the surface and actually investigate what's happening in Ukraine, you'll see. And as now, mark my words, guys, as the Russian troops liberate more and more towns and cities, we're going to have evidence and terrible stories and tragic stories of atrocities that have been committed in the last 8 years.
Yeah.
You know, you will need a whole, you know, Nuremberg 2.0 trial in Kiev to look at them all, to look at all these cases. And so many innocent people were killed. It's a regime that was built on bloodshed and murder of political opponents and murder of Russians, you know, not even political opponents. They didn't really care about political opponents.
Yeah.
You know, some may accuse Putin of that, you know, say Novichok and Navalny and so forth. But the Kiev regime wasn't even interested in political opponents. You know what they were interested in? They were interested on an ideological level.
Yeah.
On a Nazi level, they considered Russians as, you know, subhumans. It's very, very sick. They actually taught, you know, their children.
Yeah.
You have to kill Russians. They call the Russians all these names. And they brought up a whole generation in the last 8 years of ideologically twisted fanatics. And these are the fanatics now that are holding out and causing problems and killing civilians and running rampant.
The honorable soldiers,
the conscripts, the regular soldiers of the Ukrainian army, I mean, these are, most of them are Russians and they're ex-Soviet soldiers. And they knew straight away, as soon as the war started, They thought, we're not fighting with the Russians. Straight away, bang, resign. Yeah, bang. They just literally walked across the border with their hands up. And the Russians said, there you go, boys, come through. You know, what can we get you?
Yeah.
What are you having? Cigarettes, water, drinks,
yeah.
You know, lunch, you know, warm shower, place to sleep. No worries, we'll evacuate you. And no problems.
It's like...
Yeah, no need for any... No POW camps or concentration camps. Very humane, very respectful.
It's like the West has got a very, very short memory. A lot of people... And again, history being taught in a certain way. A lot of people probably attribute the winning of World War II down to, like, the Americans. When the truth of the matter is, it was obviously the Russians on the Eastern Front with Hadley. How many did you say? How many Russians died in World War II?
More Russians died in World War II.
Yeah.
Than people live in Australia.
Yeah.
Put it that way.
Yeah.
So imagine the whole of Australia killed in one go.
Wow.
In 4 years.
Wow.
That's how many Russians died.
It just, you know, without Russia, that whole thing would have been a completely different, you know, who knows what the world
would be. Well, look, the statistic is, the official statistic is that 80% of German troops died against Russians.
Yeah.
So 20% of Germans, Wehrmacht,
yeah,
died facing, you know, the Canadians, the Americans, the French, the British.
Yeah,
you know, all the countries that were involved, 20%, 80% against the Russians.
Wow.
Very, very heavy battles, very heavy fighting.
Wow.
And unfortunately, tragically, you know, today, yesterday, day before, there were very heavy battles in those same places in Kharkov. Very heavy tank battles in Kharkov. And again, we've got tanks in Kharkov. The Ukrainians are bombing Kharkov now because the Russians, when the Russians take over the city, as the Ukrainians retreat, they bomb the city. It's terrible that they would do that, you know. And we've seen these examples of Ukrainian, it's not the Ukrainian army, it's these Ukrainian nationalist battalions. This is who Hunter Biden was associated with. This is who they got all their dodgy deals done. You know, this regime, this Nazi sort of, these biolabs and these circumvention of human rights and these atrocities that they committed. And this is why Putin's gone in there. He's gone in there to save the civilian population, to fix the country, to return the country to, you know, being safe and prosperous and, you know, a brotherly neighbor. You know, the Americans exploited this situation. They really pushed it too far. You know, the fact that they're sending in, I think Joe Biden since December, I think now the number is sort of about $5 billion is sent in of weapons. You know, the Ukrainian Kiev regime, they're handing out weapons on the streets to people. It's ordered by the government. The trucks pull up, they just open the back, and anyone takes whatever they want. They don't even check your license, your passport, your date of birth, how old you are, whatever. Just open the crates, whoever wants. Yeah, you want a heavy assault rifle, you want an anti-tank weapon, what else you want? Molotov cocktail. It's the Wild West.
I think
the Wild West.
What you said earlier was a very, very valid point. Like, how would America and Americans feel if Putin suddenly started sending billions and billions of dollars or of money of weapons to Mexico and the drug cartels, you know, hypothetically the same thing? How would they feel about that, you know?
Why doesn't Putin do an experiment, you know? And why doesn't Putin, you know, Putin should put up a Twitter post, hashtag I stand with the cartels. You know, all of a sudden the American dollar will drop 20%. You know, there'll be the Americans will back off, and you know, the NATO will back off, because that's what he's doing. That's what the Germans and the Americans and the French are doing now in Ukraine. They're backing cartels. They're backing criminal groups.
Yeah.
They're backing Nazi battalions.
I noticed
drive around killing civilians.
I noticed the shares in all these huge defense companies has gone crazy. I mean, that's what they want, obviously, but. It's insanity.
War is good for business for them.
Yeah, war is good for business. So what advice would you give to anyone? Just switch off mainstream media and look at more alternative, you know, dig deeper, right? Look, do your own research. Don't believe the mainstream media.
Well, put it this way, mate. There's a saying that we have in Australia on our channel, in the Aussie Cossack channel, is make sure you're on the right side of history. And this is, I think, the message before we wrap this up is... To everyone, make sure you're on the right side of history.
Yeah.
And in this situation with Vladimir Putin, many people jumped to conclusions very quickly. The smart people you know, win by the fog of war rule, you know, wait 24 to 48 hours. Those people that waited and those people now are waking up. And there's nothing wrong with if you were confused or you were tricked by the mainstream media. Nothing wrong with, you know, coming around to the truth now. That's just the same thing that happened with, remember, with the pandemic. A lot of people went along with it.
Yeah.
And they got the first one and they got the second one and they said, hang on a second, I'm not getting the third one. Or they got the third one, or the fourth one, fifth one. It's just a matter of time before you realize. And the people that are quick and on the ball and that understand history, understand politics, understand what the cabal is, what the establishment is, and what they're capable of, they understand. They saw it straight away.
Yeah.
You saw it straight away. Many of the people listening to this program, and I think a lot of people in the comments section are going to give their opinion as to what they saw, as to what, you know, evidence they have, as to what they picked up on. You know, because this is where it unfolds. The establishment is exposed in social media through independent journalists, just like yourself. And guys, if you're out there listening, help this gentleman out. He's doing a good job. He's got his studio set up. He's an independent journalist. Let's subscribe to the channel, share this video, and we'll come back with more updates. We'll talk war with Australia and Britain. We'll do a question and live answer next time, hopefully.
Yeah.
So I think for you to go live, you need 1,000 subscribers. So, guys, smash the subscribe button. Let's give this fella what he deserves. And let's get some live streams going with the Aussie Cossack.
Perfect. Yeah, sounds great. Yeah, like I said, thank you so much for coming on. We really appreciate you giving us your time. Everything that obviously the Aussie Cossack has been talking about, his YouTube channel and Telegram group, we'll put links in the description below. And we'll be further updates during this week. If you'd like any questions to be answered by the Aussie Cossack, please just put it in the comments below. And we'll see you again all very, very shortly. Thanks again. And talk to you very soon.
All the best. God bless everyone.
Cheers. Bye.
Peace for Ukraine and Russia. Bye-bye.
Peace.
Hey, guys.